curing patients. We're very familiar with this in the stem cell biology field, where there are hundreds and hundreds of stem cell clinics set up around the world who are offering things which are often useless, even unsafe. So there have been patients killed by the use of this technology. So it requires really tough governance. The WHO published a report in 2021. I was on the committee that did this, looking at governance. And there are multiple ways that you can help to try and control the activities in this space. Those have to be used, but everyone has to participate in those. The governments have to, scientists have to, clinicians have to, patient groups have to. The meeting with JK the other day, the really frustrating thing was he wasn't prepared to answer any questions in that meeting about what he's doing, and no details at all. And so you've got to have people willing to discuss with their peers what they're doing. Otherwise, it's going to go horribly wrong.
Now, from controversy to prehistoric discovery, an international team of researchers has found stone tools that they estimate to be around 2.9 million years old at a site in western Kenya. The findings are possibly the oldest examples of an important Stone Age innovation known as the Olderwan Toolkit. And there are signs that whoever was making these tools used them to butcher very large animals. The site is called Nyayanga, and there are artifacts and fossils there just eroding out of the ground, each one a piece in a puzzle revealing a time when different species of early human roamed that landscape. Anthropologist Dr. Thomas Plummer from the City University of New York is one of the researchers who made the discovery.
At Nyayanga, you've got a slope that you walk down. Lake Victoria gradually opens up in front of you as you're walking down the slope. A gully deepens alongside you, and you start seeing artifacts and fossils eroding out of the sediments. As you're walking down the slope, it opens up into a little amphitheater, and there's a lot of erosion of sediments there, a lot of fossils and artifacts on the surface.
What does it look like? Are they poking out of the ground? You can recognize that you can see these artifacts?
Yeah, you can. And, you know, you see more fossils. Fossils are always more common than artifacts, but you see both. And you can jump into the gully and walk in there, and that's where water really is rushing through during rainy seasons, and so there's a lot of erosion all the time there. And every time we walk down that gully, we see something new poking out.
And talking of something new, or something very, very old.
Right. a new old thing.
Exactly. Yeah. Where exactly are you looking? What have you discovered here that gives us this insight into stone tool use in particular, and the age of it?
We first got an idea of the age because I work with a pig expert who's named Laura Bishop in Liverpool, John Morris, and she was on the site surveying with us, and she just said, these pigs are really old. These are way older than the pigs at the other old sites we've been working at. So that was the first indication, because pigs evolve very rapidly. You can tell from the species of pig you've got and where it is in its evolutionary history. An idea of the site. She said, or she thought that site was over 2.5, just looking at the pigs. And then we had other lines of evidence that helped date it. So that was really significant. And then we actually started digging, because we had nice surface fossils, and we even had a surface human relative called Paranthropus. So we started digging where there were some hippo bones and stone tools coming out in one spot. In another spot, we started digging where there was some elephant teeth coming out. Both spots we found partial hippos with stone tools. And then when we studied them in the lab, we found slice marks made by stone tools showing that we needed a slice knife.
You're pretty confident that you're seeing a butchery site then, and a hippo butchery site at that.
Two hippo butchery sites.
And you describe it as a particular type of tool technology that had already been dated to about 2.4 million years old, but you think it's even older than that now. What is the technology you're looking at? What sort of toolkit are human ancestors using at this point?
Yeah, well, it's a toolkit that's, first of all, it's called the Olderwan. It's something called freehand percussion, where you hold a stone that you're driving flakes off of, called the core, stationary in one hand, and in your favorite hand, I'm right-handed, so it would be my right hand. You have another rock called the hammerstone, and you strike the core at just the right angle, and it knocks off a flake. And those flakes are sharp. They're just basically like the blade of a Swiss Army knife. And if you're a hominin, you can walk around the landscape with two stumps, and every time you need to either pound or cut something, you've got the technology to do it. You can knock a flake off for cutting, or you could use the hammer stone for pounding things. So it's a very simple technology, but it allowed them to process a wide range of foods that they wouldn't have had access to before. It previously had been known, the oldest sites have been 2.6 million years ago from the Afar Triangle in Ethiopia. And there's a site now in China, 2.1 million years old, that shows that maybe old one hominids were out there that early. So the old ones, the first technology seen in the evolutionary history of humanity that actually spreads and lasts for hundreds of thousands of years.
What were they using this for? Is this specifically butchery of large animals, or is this kind of a toolkit for lots of different things that these communities would need in their lives to hunt and prepare other food? What do they use the whole toolkit for?
So we saw the butchery in the hippo, and there's some antelope bones that have butchery marks on them as well. But they're also processing plant foods, cleaning and pounding tubers to make them easier to eat, because everything's being eaten raw. So you've got to imagine that the food is much harder to eat. And also woodworking. So they're probably making wooden tools from the stone tools, because there's some woodworking on the edges of some of the tools.
And when you say that they, what hominid are we talking about? What early human was this? Do we know?
We'll see them sharing fish at the surface, and we've started doing studies with drones to actually get kind of this bird competing with your other offspring.
Finding her.
We'll ask the former detective chief inspector if criticisms of police handlings of the case are justified. In the latest stage of their industrial action, the RCN has announced in the last few minutes that nurses in England will stage a 48-hour strike from the 1st of March. We'll bring you the latest on that. As the parent company of British Gas announces record profits, one customer who had a prepared toxic chemical spill, the crisis...
of quelling things, social media is a beast that doesn't get quelled very easily.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because Nazir Afzal, who was the chief crown prosecutor for the northwest of England, said it should never have been issued because it gives fuel to victim blamers, armchair sleuths and conspiracy theorists.
I don't think there's any aspect of victim blaming here. The relevance of this information to the police investigation is right at the beginning in terms of the risk assessment. And it was taken into account with all the other information. The Lancashire Police categorised Nicola as a high-risk missing person, partially because of these vulnerabilities, partly because of other factors, I'm sure. But they've categorised her as high-risk right from the very start. Now, historically, the police have been criticised for not getting involved quick enough, for their being a bit slow off the mark with missing person inquiries before they sort of, you know, get involved and start doing things. That wasn't the case here. Yeah, and I don't think Lancashire can be faulted on the investigation itself. And they were trying to explain, the press conference, as far as I could make out, the first press conference yesterday, as far as I could make out, was to explain what had happened in some detail, so that people knew what had happened and what had been done and why it had been done. And that involved that risk assessment right at the beginning.
But it was only the disclosure around issues of the menopause and alcohol didn't come out until later on. It wasn't in the original statements that we heard in Greece. I wonder, why hasn't it been said before then? Because we've heard these allegations about people visiting the crime scene, social media damage, for many days up until now. Why has it only just come out?
It's not something the police will have released with any sort of desire to release it. They'll have done so reluctantly, and I get the distinct impression that, like I say, they were bouncing to it a little bit. They could and should have stopped saying she was high risk. As soon as they mentioned vulnerabilities, I sort of cringed and thought, that isn't one of the good things, because, you know, someone will pick that up and they won't let it go until they find out what those vulnerabilities were, and that's going to involve private information, I'm sure. And lo and behold, it did. They shouldn't have gone any further, I don't think. That said, it does appear from the family statement that it was done in the full knowledge of the family.
Yeah,
so the police have liaised with the family and said, this is what we're going to do. Yeah, this is what we're going to do. This is why we're doing it. It doesn't totally excuse it. The police have got to make a professional decision. We can't dodge that. But at least the family have been involved. It's not something that's just been done. No, it's certainly not been done to blame the victim in any way.
No, but you suggested there might have been an element of naivety. Do you think that decision would have been taken by a sufficiently senior ranking police officer working
with you? I suspect it probably was at one level. If I recall that first press conference correctly, they mentioned high risk, and then the vulnerabilities was mentioned on the way to a question, I believe. That wouldn't have been discussed in huge detail, and it might have been, I think it was the superintendent, it might have been the superintendent sort of deciding to say that on the spur of the moment, on the hoop, as it were. And sometimes misjudgments are made on that basis.
We've only got a few seconds left, but I just wonder from your experience how you do draw the line between information gathering and encouragement, and what do you decide to put out in the public domain to bring people forward if the investigation isn't making enough progress?
It's hugely difficult. Media attention and media coverage is really important to get messages out. If you're looking for a particular car or person or whatever it might be, it's hugely important. So you're trying to sort of keep the interest of the media, but not give them too much. And you certainly don't want to be putting things out there that then result in a snowstorm of stuff that just distracts the investigation and doesn't take you anywhere.
Thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. Bringing the time now to 16 minutes past five. And here's Jim now with some of our other headlines.
The leader of Belarus, Alexander Lukashenko, has told BBC he remains willing for Russia to use his country to launch fresh attacks against Ukraine. Labour is promising to put a named police officer in every neighbourhood and guarantee community patrols if he wins the next election. The Spanish Parliament has approved a new law making it easier for people to legally change their recognised gender.
The Royal College of Nursing has announced its biggest walkout of AIDS people in England. Its members, half of the hospital's mental health and community services, will take part in 48 hours straight from the 1st to the 3rd of March. And this time the union will no longer allow for blanket exemptions in key areas like critical care and chemotherapy services. Hugh Pym is our health editor. Hugh, you've been following these strikes all the way through. Do you really feel that this is ramping up the industrial action?
It's certainly tightening it up, because up until now we've had back-to-back strikes, one day followed by another, but each of them has been 12 hours. This time it'll be a constant 48 hours of walkouts, and the dates in question that have been announced today by the Royal College of Nursing are 48 hours from 6 a.m. on Wednesday, March the 1st, until 6 a.m. on Friday, March the 3rd. In England, of course, the Welsh and Scottish governments are in negotiations with unions, and they've made higher offers, but no new offer at this stage forthcoming from the government at Westminster. And Pat Cullen of Royal College of Nursing, the General Secretary, has said by refusing to negotiate, the Managing Department is pushing more people into strike action. Steve Hartley, Secretary of State for Health, covering England, has said it's a significant escalation which risks patient safety. Now, the big difference that we've alluded to is that whereas before each hospital had its own negotiations with the local strike committee of the RCA over exemptions, many delegations and areas of power were covered, and national level commitments to carrying on with intensive care, chemotherapy and cancer services, or some cancer services. This time there will be none of that, no local agreements at all. The starting point will be that RCA members, nurses in all these areas, will be on strike over those 48 hours, and that's to negotiate any exemptions will require hospital managements to get in touch with the RCN nationally and make their case. So that's a considerable change from what we've had before. There will be a national agreement over small areas of critical care, such as emergency response to serious road traffic accidents and major incidents, but that's quite a limited national agreement. So it really does add an extra layer of complication at a time when NHS leaders have certainly been saying it's difficult enough managing this at the moment, doing all these negotiations at local level.
And services will be asked to use nurses that aren't members of RCN or other health professionals to cover during this strike, which is the first time they have to continue supporting the strike. Thanks very much for that update. We will follow that story closely. Let's move on now to news from NATO. Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg has warned of a face-off between Russia and the West that could last for many years as the first anniversary approaches of the invasion of Ukraine. Finland, which borders Russia and Sweden, to join NATO, Turkey's been blocking accession to the alliance. There's particular antipathy to Sweden, which Ankara accuses of harbouring militants from the banned Kurdistan Workers' Party, the PKK, which took up arms against the Turkish state in 1984. We asked the former Prime Minister of Finland, Alexander Stubb, whether he was worried by the recent reports.
I'm not overly concerned because I think we need to look at the big picture. Remember that our process of accession has been the fastest in NATO's history. I firmly believe that Finland and Sweden will both be members by the summit meeting in Vilnius in July, so we're talking about a few months. Then we'll see whether Turkey will ratify our membership before the Swedish one. But in the bigger scheme of things, I don't think that really matters that much because both countries have security guarantees as we speak, and both countries will be members of NATO in July.
But in practical terms, you're saying that Finland could go ahead with ratification even if Sweden doesn't go alongside?
Well, I think the official line from the president, the government and the parliament is to say that we shall continue our path towards NATO hand in hand. At the same time, we do have parliamentary elections here in Finland on the 2nd of April. So parliament will ratify most probably our membership before that. So if push comes to shove, we can become members earlier. But I'm not 100% sure whether that's going to happen. It's just all going to depend on what Turkey does. And I do think that for tragic reasons, Turkey has its handful right now with the earthquake. So again, I think the base case is that we'll join together in July.
It does, but President Erdogan's made clear that he's less happy about the Swedish accession, for example, over its refusal to extradite people allegedly tied to Kurdish militant groups.
Yeah, I think that's been the basic message. And you know, he has made claims on that, but from what I understand, the Swedes have done everything that has been required by the so-called protocol or arrangement that they signed last summer. So legally speaking, I don't think there should be any problems. Then, of course, there are elections in Turkey as well on the 14th of May. And from what I understand, you know, Erdogan's position as president is quite threatened. So there might be some political motives behind this position as well.
NATO, we're told, has to be ready for a new era of standoff with Russia that could last a long time. Are you perfectly content, and are the people of Finland perfectly content to be a signed up part of that?
Oh yes, definitely. And the reason is very simple. I think this is a win-win situation for Finland, for the Baltic Sea region, for the Nordic countries and for the Baltics and for NATO, because We are basically a security provider. Remember that we didn't run down our military when the Cold War ended. Quite the contrary, we ramped it up. So therefore, we have 900,000 men in reserves. We can mobilize 280,000 in wartime. We have over 60 F-18s. We just bought 64 F-35s. We have one of the most sophisticated defense material systems in the world. And we do not have that because we're afraid of Stockholm, if you know what I mean. So I think NATO understands and we understand that this will be, I think, not only a marriage of convenience, but one based on values.
And before that marriage is signed and sealed, do you fear that in the run-up to the anniversary and what we're expecting to be a further Russian offensive in Ukraine, that the tentacles could spread into Finland? Could you risk having an incursion on your soil before you are part of the NATO family?
No, I don't think so. And I don't think that was the base case from the beginning either. We have to understand that the Russian military has not only underperformed, but it simply doesn't have the resources. What we have prepared for and seen is different types of cyber hybrid activity. You know, it's been in violating our airspace, or it's been on using our information systems. But other than that, I think if you're talking about conventional attacks, it simply is not going to happen. It's not in the cards.
That's the former Prime Minister of Finland, Alexander Stubb. Time now, 5:24. The death toll from last week's earthquake in southern Turkey and northern Syria is over 41,000 since the 7.8 magnitude quake struck. 11 days on, remarkably, there are still some people being pulled from the rubble, including a 17-year-old girl who's been found alive. But sadly, those moments are becoming rarer by the hour. Our correspondent, Laura Bicker, is in Antakya. Laura, you were on PM yesterday as silence was being asked for, as somebody was being rescued, hopefully. You've been seeing so many things over the last few days. Tell us what the situation's like now.
Well, unfortunately, no one was able to be rescued from the building last night. I should explain, I was several hundred metres away with other rescue teams, and I had checked before we talked to you last night, so it was safe to continue talking.
Yeah, absolutely,
but I think
absolutely.
It's important, and yeah.
Yeah, we just appreciated you taking us there.
I think it's important to say that, but I think within Antakya, the scene is apocalyptic. I don't think the scale of the damage has been fully comprehended. Every single street you go down, there's barely a building that remains untouched. Right now, throughout Antakya, all you hear is the constant thud and churn of diggers pulling away at the remains of these buildings. Now, they are thoroughly checking each of these buildings before they pull them down. I've seen teams from Mexico, Australia, South Korea, all coming to kind of rappel down. They use ropes, they go through each of these concertinaed buildings. They shout, they scream, they ask if anyone's there. And today I asked one of the Mexican teams, I said, look, you know, do you think? And she said, maybe, maybe, maybe. But she said, usually it's no. Then, after they've checked, the building is flattened. And right now, Antakya is full of dust. It's full of concrete. The air is thick. It is pretty inhospitable in places. Most of the people who are still here are people who have nowhere else to go.
Laura, it's obviously terribly distressing for those who are trying desperately to save lives, but now it's also a case of helping the survivors and giving them some form of shelter as well.
Well, there are a number of tents, and certainly Turkey says it's got every single tent manufacturer on board, and there are a number of tent camps, but I think Antakya is so inhospitable in places. We have no heating, no food. There are volunteers giving out food, but the queue is long. There's no kind of running water. There are no facilities. Many people are just deciding, okay, fine, let's leave. They are moving further north. So even the camps further north, they can have electricity or some supplies, but within Antakya, that's impossible.
Laura Bicker in Turkey, thanks ever so much for us in Antakya. Look, we were telling you a little bit earlier about the nurses now staging a 48-hour strike from the 1st of March, and it seems as if the RMT are going to also be taking strike action. Nationwide strike action across the railways on the 16th of March has been announced, they say, after employers refuse to put any new offers on the table. The union represents 40,000 workers across Network Rail, and 14 train operators rejected offers from employers last week as they didn't meet the needs of the members on pay, job security or working conditions, the RMT. So that's strike action nationwide on the 16th of March.
Last week, in the early hours of Monday morning, an earthquake with its epicenter near the city of Gaziantep struck southeastern Turkey and northwestern Syria. As of now, estimates are that over 40,000 people have died. Of course, this was an act of God, as insurers call it. But how much of the devastation was inevitable, and how much could have been avoided? And what are the longer-term political and human consequences in a region part of which is still...
No.
could soon possibly be joined by Welsh rugby players. An ongoing impasse over contracts and finances in the regional game is threatening to spill onto the international stage, with players questioning whether to walk out ahead of their home Six Nations clash with England in Cardiff on Saturday the 25th of February. The Wales head coach Warren Gatland was asked at a press conference today if he would support a decision by his players to boycott the game against England.
No. I mean, I completely support the stance that they're taking in terms of wanting to get some resolution about the issues that they have. But I think there's a lot more things at stake in terms of ensuring that that fixture does take place.
Thomas Morgan is our correspondent in Cardiff. Thomas, he doesn't sound too happy. Tell us a bit more about the reasons the players are giving for threatening to take strike action.
Yeah, well, I mean, as you mentioned there, the Welsh rugby players have been in a dispute with bosses about a long-term pay agreement. And the new, well, that financial agreement between the regions, the four professional regions, the four clubs, and the Welsh Rugby Union has still to be confirmed in writing. And essentially, the WRU and the region, well, I've told the regions and the players, the regions will be paying you too much. We can't give this much, so you're going to have to take some sort of pay cut. But it also means actually that the clubs haven't been able to re-sign players and haven't been able to add to recruitment. So there's this impasse, which means a sizable number of players who are out of contract could be, well, they don't know where they'll be playing come at the end of the season in June, really. So you heard there from Warren Gatland, the Wales head coach, saying that he wouldn't support the strike, but he fully sympathises with the players. Also in that press conference today was Wales' most capped player, Alan Wynne-Jones, a member of the Welsh Rugby Players Association. He said the players have completely had enough. The approach by the WRU was unprofessional and wanted it resolved as soon as possible because, you know, the threat of action, strike action, was hard to deny. And he said, if you treat people this badly for long enough, you get to where you found yourselves now. And I think what's significant about this Wales-England game, really, you know, this is the biggest money earner for the W and for Cardiff and for Welsh rugby, really, when it comes to a one-off event. It happens every 2 years in Cardiff, the Six Nations game in the Principality. And given the money issues in the WRU, the last thing that they want is for the players to go on strike. But as Alan Wynne-Jones said, if there's no resolution, that's what would happen.
So big impact, both financially and emotionally, then, this Six Nations fixture on the Welsh rugby calendar.
Yeah, it's a huge, really, and that's difficult to see, you know, the impact of what it will have exponentially if it doesn't go ahead and these players do go on strike. But ultimately, this development, this delay in contract evidence, it's further evidence that this is an organisation, the W, which is in complete turmoil at the moment. There have been allegations of sexism, homophobia, racism. The CEO's had to resign. There's a vote on the restructuring of the organisation coming up. And the first team brought back their most successful coach of all time after a losing streak. Mm. But they still can't win a game. And now you have this situation. So a really damning situation. It looks like the Welsh rugby jersey is really tearing at the seams.
Thomas Morgan in Cardiff, thanks so much. It is just past 5:45. Here's Jim now with our other stories.
The Labour leader Keir Starmer has said during a visit to Kiev that if he wins the next election, he will maintain Britain's commitment to Ukraine and the war with Russia. The Ministry of Defence says the RAF has now flown 15 tonnes of aid to Turkey. More than 100 British medical specialists are now helping with the relief effort following the devastating earthquakes. Pope Francis has dismissed speculation that he plans to follow the example of his predecessor, Benedict, by retiring.
Jim, thank you. Nearly 2 weeks ago, a train crash in the state of Ohio in America left a small town of East Palestine, home to nearly 5,000 people, worried that it was being poisoned by toxic chemicals. A public meeting that was meant to ease residents' fears only heightened anger when the rail firm at the heart of the disaster failed to show up, citing security concerns. Well, lawsuits have now been filed against the train company. Meanwhile, the governor of Ohio, Mike DeWine, has warned residents living near the site to drink bottled water. And this was the mayor of East Palestine, Trent Conaway, speaking to residents.
My greatest concern is that my citizens feel safe. That's what I care about. I don't care about anything else. I don't care about getting reports on TV. I want you all safe. I want my citizens. I want this. I don't want 50 cameras around me. I want to be watching a basketball game here, watching my kids play in this gym. People keep forgetting. I'm a local politician. I live in this town.
Well, Ben Ratner lives there and has had to evacuate from his home. Earlier today, he told the BBC the situation was really worrying.
There's so many people on well water, and they were very clear today and said, I wouldn't drink any well water until you get tested and cleared. They were very clear about that. And there's a lot of people around that are on well water. There's farms in the area that have to feed their animals or have their crops, watered with well water. So that's a concern.
Well, at the meeting today, the head of Ohio's health department reassured residents that the concentrations of toxins in the air and in water supplies were far below that which could harm humans. We approached Norfolk Southern Railway Company for a statement. They didn't give us one, but directed us to information, including a letter that they've sent to residents where they say, quotes, crews are cleaning the site thoroughly, responsibly and safely. Together with local health officials, we have implemented a comprehensive testing program to ensure the safety of East Palestine's water, air and soil. Karen Kausler is State Health Bureau Chief at Ohio Public Radio and Television. And Karen, no doubt this has really been occupying the airwaves. Can you talk us through what happened at that town hall meeting?
Well, there were hundreds of residents who crowded into a high school gymnasium, and they were demanding answers from Norfolk Southern, the railroad, which, like you said, did not attend the meeting last night, and also from officials who have been saying the air and drinking water are safe. And Norfolk Southern, like you said, has promised to clean up the site. Governor Mike DeWine has said the state will sue the railroad if it doesn't. The Environmental Protection Agency has said that residents can safely return to their homes, but there are a lot of people who are very concerned about the air and water. Some residents are claiming they're sick and they have headaches or rashes. There are bad smelling fumes around town. And perhaps you've seen the pictures of this enormous dark cloud that came up over the community after that controlled burn of vinyl chloride following the train derailment. A lot of people are very concerned about that and say, how in the world could water and air be safe when that's what we've been looking at?
It's going to take a lot to reassure them, isn't it? Particularly, I suppose, if they've watched the film White Noise. I mean, it's really coincidental, but it was one of the filming locations for that movie, came out in 2022. And it's a film with effectively the same storyline, isn't it?
Yeah, it's really very strange. I believe that supposedly takes place several years ago, but the idea of exactly the same circumstance almost, that you had a derailment causing an environmental concern, crisis, disaster, whatever word you want to use for that movie, that's on the minds of people. And there still is this claim and backing it up with data showing that water and air and even soil are so far proving to be within levels that are not causing concern. But of course, there are folks who just aren't yet ready to believe that.
And so how long do you think it will take before some sort of sense of normality returns?
Well, I think Norfolk Southern has a real crisis here in terms of the residents who had to be evacuated. We're talking several thousand people who had to leave the area for that controlled burn and that fiery burn off that happened there. They have been trying to get some sort of reimbursement from Norfolk Southern. Norfolk Southern has said it set up $1 million fund to do that, but some people are saying they're having trouble cashing checks and even getting their hands on these checks. And reimbursement comes in a lot of different forms. Homeowners are saying their home values might go down over this. And of course, restoring any problems that might be with private wells, that's a real concern as well.
Karen Kausler, thank you. Nicola Sturgeon's shock announcement yesterday still being digested in the world of politics. She joins a growing list of former leaders. In fact, it made us realise what a turnaround there's been in the party leaders since the gang of them that fought the 2019 election.
We deserve better than the Farage-Johnson-Trump nightmare.
There's only one reason why we're having this election. That is that we have a deadlocked parliament that will not deliver Brexit.
This election is the most important in our lifetimes. At stake is not just Brexit, but what kind of society we want to be.
You can make history shine a light in the darkness with your vote.
I formed the Brexit Party because I'm...
out to London, boroughs, and indeed Surrey may be thinking in terms of...
Colin, surely Bromley benefits from you, Les. The inner London and central London, because those people who are driving there have had to change their vehicles. You've already benefited. So is there a compromise here where Bromley, let's not speak about the other boroughs, let's speak about you and your borough. What could the mayor do or the mayor's office do for you to be behind you, Les?
Provide a rational case of how it would help to improve health and air quality in Bromley, because the reports they have produced doesn't actually improve air quality in Bromley. If it did, there's arguably a case. I think the argument would be against, but there's arguably a case. The stats they have pulled together, their own research, tells us that even if you do extend ULEZ to the M25 boundaries, it won't improve air quality in Bromley. And indeed other outer London boroughs.
Absolutely, Colin, and I will tell you that a lot of the listeners that contact us are very much in agreement with you. They're unhappy about the scheme. They feel there can be modifications or it should be scrapped. But I must quickly ask, if you don't mind, in your position as the leader of Bromley Council, is there a point? Do you have an amount of money that you would stop spending? You know, if it goes over that 150,000 you've talked about, I know that's a rough figure, would you stop the challenge in the High Court? Because again, this impacts what you can spend on the people that live in Bromley.
Well, Kat, ultimately, the case will cost more if we lose, because we'll end up paying the mayor's costs. We're not starting out to lose. We believe that we will win, and if we do, it should cost very little, because the mayor may have to pay our costs.
Are you...
I'm really, really keen to drive out. What we're about is looking after the interests of vulnerable people in Bromley that can't afford this, and of businesses in Bromley who are quite literally on the cusp of going out of business and putting people out of jobs because they can't afford the 10, 20, 30,000 quid it will cost to buy new compliant vans and lorries, which aren't even available. There's a shortage of them.
But there is another option. You could campaign to the government. You could go to the government and ask them to help fund with an extra money for the scrappage scheme, so they could be helped. Maybe they could get double the cash if you got the government involved. That's the conversation we had from our correspondent earlier, that we heard as a thought coming from the mayor's office. Your response?
My response to that, Kat, is that if the mayor doesn't listen to us, because we believe our case is just and our cause is good, we will be looking for the government to step in, just as they did in Scotland recently, albeit for a completely different reason, and intervene to curb the mayor's powers, because ultimately we believe he's completely out of control and he's trying to install these measures illogically and against the interests of outer London residents.
So if this isn't successful, you intend to go straight to the government to get them to step in, intervene and stop it?
Well, we've already basically indicated that through various interviews. You will have seen Lord Moylan and Boris Johnson predominantly already articulating the same argument. So yes, we're up for the fight, Kat, but we really don't think this is fair for outer London.
I am incredibly grateful for you being patient with me and allowing me to challenge and to push you a little. And I hope you have a wonderful evening, and thank you so much for talking to us.
Kat, an absolute pleasure, and thank you for asking me on.
All right, take care. Councillor Colin Smith, the leader of Bromley Council, reacting to the story we've been telling you about. We've been hearing about those five councils announcing they're bringing legal action against TfL and the London Mayor over his decision to expand the ultra-low emission zone to outer London boroughs. Blimey.
Yes.
Thursday night, turmoil in North London, European blues for Chelsea, plenty of the oval ball and a bit of boxing too.
The sound of London.
The London Sports Show.
BBC Radio London.
Yeah, hello there. Mark Church, Dudley Bird, Jake Hart, me, Phil Parry with you for the next 2 hours. The title charge for the Gunners. Has it hit a buffer or has it been totally spiked?
Royner cuts it back to Haaland. 3-1 to Manchester City. Erling Haaland and Kevin De Bruyne combine to surely put this game to bed. Manchester City go top of the Premier League ahead of Arsenal, who have been the league leaders for so long.
Chelsea is still misfiring, this time in Europe.
The spirit's there in the team. It's just we need a little bit of luck, I think, and we need to carry on the performance level that we had tonight, and we need to try to keep improving. That's the job.
Plenty to get our teeth into on the rugby front as well this evening. Domestically, the men's premiership returns this weekend. The Premier 15s has a rather huge game taking place in North London.
The crowd's going to be sensational. Harlequins obviously are going to bring their A game, but it's about what we do and how we're going to break them down and just making sure that we make sure that we're like dominant, physical in our carries, and you know, when we're in that 22 coming away with points.
We'll talk strikes and so much more in connection with the international game, with the Six Nations 2 weeks in, having a bit of a break. The 13-player code as well features on the programme tonight. The Broncos have made a solid start, losing the first game, but winning away in Cumbria last time out before heading up to Halifax this weekend. Of course, this being Thursday, there's boxing. Ron Bodie joins us later on as well. And we will talk a little bit of NFL, because there's no place like Mahomes in Kansas. Sorry.
BBC Radio London.
The home of London sport.
Evening, welcome along. My microphone seems a bit droopy. Maybe it's just the way it is. It's 7 minutes past eight. No, 7 minutes past six. On a Thursday evening, the 16th of February, halfway through February already. Goodness gracious me, it'll be Christmas before we know it, and we'll be talking about all sorts of nonsense yet again this time and next season. Welcome along. Thank you to Kath for the last 4 hours. BBC Sounds, where you can get that programme back in your life. Lots of debate, of course, later on about ULEZ, etc., etc. That is a story we will continue to cover here on BBC Radio London. As we do with our sports stories, 2 hours tonight to look at everything that's happened, what may happen, what is still to come over the next few days, weeks and months as well. Mark Church is in the studio with me, so we've got Jake Hart here as well. We're going to talk Arsenal, Tottenham, Chelsea. We're going to talk rugby with the Six Nations, striking Welsh players, potentially. Maybe Wales being represented by Ealing. What is that about? And so much more between now and 8 o'clock, Churchy. It is never dull, it is never quiet, and you don't really need any Haribos to just to have London sport to be buzzy, don't you, really?
Two things early on. Excellent opening from you there with your Wizard of Oz reference.
Thank you very much. I went to see Wicked for the 10th time
and
the other week.
Cynical rugby reference, say that Wales have already been on strike for the first two rounds.
Oh, you've used my line. Thank you.
No, I wanted to get in there before we get off Rental later. But that's an interesting story which we'll get into on.
Well, there's two.
The Ealing one.
Ealing Trail Finders being a Welsh region. I'm
away from Cardiff.
I would say our friends at Old Deer Park might have something to say about that. I would have thought London Welsh being a bit of a giveaway in the name. That's another story, isn't it? And lots to talk about as well when it comes to football and cricket, of course, very briefly. Have we finished the day yet? Cricket one?
Hasn't started yet, day two.
Oh, no, it hasn't started.
Tomorrow morning. So yes. It's a day-nighter, this one. Pink ball. Never understood why they'd play day-night cricket. Don't get it. Complete waste of time. Just play two normal test matches. But there we are. We're under the lights in New Zealand. And we'll have a little look at that later on in the show.
Yeah, we are. And we're going to talk boxing a little bit later. And on Saturday, special boxing guests for the Women's Sports Show, Mark.
Yes, and we're really looking forward to it, actually. There's a lot of good fighters around at the moment, aren't there? And I'm not going to give too much away because we'll sort of give the name a bit later in the show. But we do have a very special guest coming in to join us for a whole hour. One of the greatest prospects in world boxing, in women's world boxing, is joining us. So we'll let you know who that is a bit later in the show. Of course, Ron will be here as well later, who will know all about this young lady.
Yeah.
But she is our special guest on Saturday with Gemma Stevenson.
Excellent. So we've got a lot to get in between now and 8 o'clock on BBC Radio London. The scene taken to the air at 8. By the way, in the Europa League this evening, the knockout round playoffs. It's a snappy title, isn't it? Round of 32, I think we're going to call it. Barcelona 0, Manchester United 0, RB Salzburg 0-0 with Roma. Shakhtar Donetsk 1-0 up against Rennes. Ajax 0, Union Berlin 0. The Europa Conference League knockout round playoffs. By the time we've got through these, it'll be half six, won't it? Bodo Glimt 0, Lech Poznan 0. Karabag are goalless with Genk, Sporting Braga and Fiorentina likewise. Trabzonspor and FC Basel. And tonight in the Arnold Clark Cup, England play South Korea. Currently, it is Italy 1, Belgium 1. Let's have a look back at the big game at the top of the Premier League last night, shall we? Manchester City 3-1 winners at Arsenal. It means that they move to the top of the table for the first time since Bonfire Night. And there were fireworks last night too.
Was a 4-1, and Kevin De Bruyne has put Manchester City in front. A short back pass from Tomiyasu. Kevin De Bruyne got there ahead of Aaron Ramsdale with an exquisite finish. Finds the back of the net. Manchester City lead.
Getting into Zinchenko, he's lost out. Rodri, though, runs into the brick wall that is Granit Xhaka. His chip ball is in for Eddie Nketiah. Out comes Edison. And it was cleared off the line. And a penalty kick has been given. It's Bukayo Saka versus Edison. And he scores! Arsenal are back on level terms, right on the stroke of half time. Arsenal aren't giving that top spot away easily. The Gunners are back level. Bukayo Saka beats Edison from the spot. It's Arsenal 1, Manchester City 1. City, Erling Haaland and Kevin De Bruyne combined.
to surely put this game to bed. Manchester City go top of the Premier League. And then of Arsenal have been the league leaders for so long. Yes, the Gunners have played a game less, but Manchester City look as though they'll be headed back to top spot.
There we go. It was Arsenal's first home defeat in the league all season. It now means the Gunners have only picked up 1 point from the last three games. After the match, Mikel Arteta spoke to BBC Radio 5 Live's Rob Scofield.
Yeah, really disappointed because we lost the game. And when I say we, is we cannot get 3 goals like we did against Manchester City. And it's a shame because they demand you to play at the best level that there is in football, and I think we have reached that level. It was a huge battle, and I think we have the feeling that we're going to win the battle, and then we just give 3 very, very harsh goals away, and the big chances that we have, we didn't put them away. When that happens, no chance to win it.
What was your message to the players afterwards? It seems to suggest that you've seen on the pitch from Manchester City essentially maybe a different edge, or maybe what it takes to be champions, as you've mentioned in the past.
More, because they didn't want to play the game that they played today, City. And believe more that you can do it and be more ruthless, because if you are, you're going to have a good chance.
Pendulum swinging back then to the way of Manchester City in the title race. Arsenal do have a game in hand. How might Arsenal respond? Joining us now in the studio, Xavi Bird, who was there last night for us, and The Athletic's Arsenal writer, Art de Roche, who was no doubt there last night as well, Art.
I wasn't, unfortunately, but I was watching. I had, I didn't get a press pass, so I was writing from home.
It was quite busy, I think, there is the impression I got. Looking at some of the newspapers, they look as if they had virtually their entire teams there, which is but not surprisingly, huge game, huge build-up. And in the end, how much of a huge blow or otherwise is this to Arsenal with title aspirations, do you think?
I feel the major thing for Arsenal at the minute is momentum. It was massive for them in the first half of the season, where it just felt like they didn't really have to think about what they were doing. It all flowed quite naturally. Whereas now, especially last night, with how Manchester City and Pep Guardiola set up that midfield, it just seemed like they had to think about so much in such a small amount of time. But going forward, Mikel Arteta mentioned in that little voice clip there, the fact that they were able to compete, I think, should at least give them some belief to hold on to for the next few weeks and months.
Because this game was due to be played back in October, and at the time, I think Arsenal were in a very, very, as a lot of managers would describe it, a good moment in the season. You know, they would describe it as that. And when you talk about that momentum, just this almost came at the wrong time for Arsenal. You know, beaten in the FA Cup, you know, just frustration with that draw against Brentford, now losing this one. It's probably at a worse time for them to play Man City.
You could kind of sense, I guess, if we're talking about Arsenal and Manchester City in moments, they're probably almost at that kind of cross level where Arsenal are slightly on the dip and Manchester City are on the rise again. But it is probably an important point, because you when you look back on these games, it often comes down to availability and then also execution. And at the minute, I don't think Arsenal played particularly badly.
No.
But there are just little moments where the execution isn't as sharp as it was, say, when they were in their better moments, like you mentioned.
Yeah, I think a big point also is that if you were to ask most Arsenal fans back in October, probably, you know, who's the two players that you can't go without if you were to go up against Manchester City, and they'd probably tell you both of them, that it would be Thomas Partey and Gabriel Jesus. I know that Nketiah's come in and he's deputised very well recently, but there's so much to Jesus' game that Nketiah doesn't bring, and I think losing Partey so late in midfield, that was a big miss for Arsenal, and they struggled to really control possession. I didn't think Jorginho had a bad game, but there is something lacking when he's not there, and I think that was a real miss as well. When you talk about when this game was supposed to happen and when it actually did happen. There's quite a lot of things that have sort of swung in Manchester City's favour, I would say.
Yeah, I mean, the other factor, I suppose, is at the start of the season, if you were to say, okay, top four is the aim for Arsenal, then people go, yep, okay, that's a realistic aim, isn't it? Suddenly, you know, having been at the top of the Premier League for so long, then Harry actually messaged me last night. He said, it is the hope that gets you every single time. And he's right, isn't it?
Yeah, 100%. I feel like the sense after the game was almost more a frustration than a straight out anger. And I think that is probably because a lot of people so far have just enjoyed the ride, really. Didn't expect Arsenal to be top of the league in February, let alone December, November, and October. Even August, we can probably go back to. And it is quite an interesting one to look at mentally, because when you're not expected to be as far along as you are, how do you deal with that?
Can I ask you a question? So you're saying that about the fans, yes, and the ride.
Yes.
Do you think the players believe they would be in this position? And does that got anything to do with it? Do you think they might be a bit further ahead than they expected?
I feel like the players who were there last season wouldn't have expected it. Mm-hmm. But Oleksandr Zinchenko's mentioned it quite a few times, where he mentioned the first kind of few training sessions he had, and he said that he felt this could be a team that challenges. And it took him a while to convince the players who were already there. So yeah. I think it's probably been a belief that's grown over the course of the season that wasn't there at the start of the year. And now you're just having to see, I guess, the hurdles that title challengers will have to face, whether you expect to be there or not.
And so much is made about the fact that this is the youngest team in the Premier League. Arsenal have got a very, very young team that's been put together. The benefit of that is that if they stay together and grow and develop, they could be a force over a period of time. On the flip side, there are one or two players in that squad who know about winning things, but not league titles. You know, well, Zinchenko, I suppose, and Jesus apart.
No,
Jorginho now.
Did he win? I don't think he won the Premier League. He won in Italy, though, hasn't he? Yeah.
Yes. But I guess it's quite interesting, even just watching Jorginho yesterday, the way you can tell by the way a player carries themselves, just what they bring, because there were these little moments in the game where you could see him talking to Eddie Nketiah, almost being a coach on the pitch. And that's what Zinchenko does a lot of. That's what Gabriel Jesus does a lot of. And I think it's those players who probably get you through trickier moments when you maybe have too much time to think about things, and you have someone who reminds you just to calm down, maybe. That's where those little moments can probably go in your favour. But I think the point about growing together is quite important for, I guess, the core of the team, because a lot of them would have gone through the disappointment of last season missing out on the Champions League. Mm. And I know a lot of them have mentioned that as something that's kind of spurred them on in the first half of the year. So it'll be interesting to see how, whether that continues on in the coming weeks.
Yeah. Oh, how do you see the next game particularly going, considering it's Aston Villa away? That's Unai Emery, who obviously had Mikel Arteta's job before he did. And Arteta keeps saying in his presses after each of the, you know, these last three results where it hasn't gone their way, that they're training really well and he's been really impressed by what he's seen, but it's not quite come good for them yet, and it feels like momentum is sort of slipping. How important is this game now coming up?
It's massive. You can't really risk losing two games on the bounce if you're going into a title challenge. The one thing I would say is it's very fine margins, it feels like. There's a moment yesterday at 1-0 where Arsenal actually play through City quite well and ball lands at Granit Xhaka's feet. And it's just, it seems like he has too many options to pick from and he doesn't make a decision. I think it's those moments in these last few weeks where it just hasn't come as smoothly to Arsenal as it previously has done. And that's what you want to probably get back to at Aston Villa, where it's again an early kickoff, 12:30 on a Saturday. And I think last year it was a similar situation where Arsenal had a midweek game against Liverpool, lost that, and then they needed to bounce back at Aston Villa, early kickoff, and they started the game really quickly. And that's been probably one of Arsenal's biggest assets this season, is how quickly they've started games and the platform that's given them. So going into Aston Villa, that's probably what they would look to do, to kind of set the tone as soon as they can and then take the game from there.
And just, I mean, I've read something by one of your colleagues, James McNicholas, who said that Arsenal played the way that they play and they suffered for it, essentially. They didn't change the way that they normally play. They consistently played out from the back in the second half, particularly when there were warning signs that things might go wrong, and ultimately that's how they conceded that really important Grealish goal. Is it a sort of similar way to, let's say, Arsene Wenger's sides of the late noughties, where they sort of had a consistent way of playing and they didn't alter it, and that ultimately meant that they came a cropper in some of these bigger games? Is that an unfair comparison?
I don't think so. It's quite interesting because if we're looking at this weekend, Unai Emery, when he was Arsenal head coach, one thing that he would do quite often was switch his game plan depending on who he was playing against, and that didn't work particularly well because there were quite a few times where you would have to make double changes at half time and things of that nature. Whereas Arteta, I think, increasingly has become set on, especially this season, because we've seen, I think, he's named 11 unchanged lineups this year. Arsenal and Mikel Arteta have their way of playing. Even before the game, Aaron Ramsdale mentioned that Arteta's main demand was be Arsenal. And I think that's where Arteta, you can see he's got shades of Wenger in him, as well as Pep Guardiola, who everybody likes to draw comparisons from.
Yeah.
I think a lot of people forget that he was under Arsene Wenger for 5 years at the end of his career. And you can see shades of that in the way his team play as well.
Being the old man on this, is it worth mentioning that Man City are actually not the worst football team in the world either, are they? they're pretty good, and they know what it is, I mean, to win.
Just to jump in on that, just the error that led to the first goal, the Tomiyasu mistake that led to Kevin De Bruyne. I was sat watching that, and I was directly behind him as he took that shot there. I think there's about one or two, maybe three max players in the world who could finish that the way that he did, first time on his left foot. And I had it, watched it from behind, it bent all the way around, up, round and over the goalkeeper. It was a terrific finish. I mean, like, you make mistakes, you get punished for them, but you still need the quality like Man City did. I mean, very few players could have done that in the way that he did there.
Who's favourites to win the Premier League now?
Big question. To be fair, it was probably always Manchester City, but yeah. I'm not gonna take Arsenal completely off the table.
No.
Just yet. I feel like there will be a response, and my hope would be that they can at least take it a few more weeks and months down the line. So I'd say City are edging it at the moment, but Arsenal are still in a very strong position. They just need to get that momentum back.
Thank you so much for your time up this evening. It's Dorosho from Athletic's Arsenal writer, who with his thoughts on what happened last night. Some interesting thoughts as well. Just elsewhere, not just last night, Tottenham Hotspurs took a stay in North London briefly. Boss Antonio Conte is going to miss Sunday's Premier League game at West Ham, or against West Ham. He has remained in Italy for his post-operation check following Tottenham's 1-0 first leg defeat in AC Milan on Tuesday in the Champions League. He had returned to work last week ahead of the 4-1 defeat to Leicester. Christian Stellini carried out the post-match media duties for that one as well. He had the operation in Italy a couple of weeks ago, and a message posted on his Instagram story this morning, Conte has said, "My great sense of responsibility towards the club, the players, the staff and the fans brought me to anticipate my comeback on the field. Sadly, I underestimated the procedure, which wasn't a routine operation, but a sudden and serious emergency. My body suffered my impatience, and now I'm forced to stop until my entire recovery. Who knows me? Understands what a burden this is for me, but it is necessary." So it's an open-ended period of time where he will not be involved. They did beat Man City when he was away in Italy having the operation. He trusts Stellini. Lots of speculation as a consequence of that. We shouldn't necessarily speculate on someone's health or otherwise, but he is going to be away for a while. We don't know what sort of impact that may have.
It's a really tricky one for Spurs and for Conte as well, because, you know, I think maybe personally my perspective is that this might be just a time for him to properly recuperate and maybe take a little bit of time out of football. Just given, you know, we've discussed the personal grievances he's had over the past year. I mean, Gianluca Vialli and Piero Bistrone, the fitness coach at Spurs, you know, he's both very, very close to him, and he's not been very well. It's not going terrifically well on the pitch for him, and he's been away from his family this entire time, so maybe he does need just quite a bit of time to sort of recuperate. But, you know, I don't know what that means for the rest of Tottenham's backroom staff right now.
Yeah, they'll probably just stay in place for the time being, won't they? But we'll have to wait and see. Elsewhere, last night Chelsea beaten 1-0 by Borussia Dortmund. Karim Adeyemi carried the ball for 50 yards before rounding Kepa to give the slender lead to the Yellow Wall ahead of the second leg in March. The result means that it's only 1 win in 9 games in all competitions for Graham Potter. Despite the result, he still believes his team continued to improve.
Their attitude's been really, really good as a group. Training as a group has been fantastic. So the spirit's there in the team. It's just we need a little bit of luck, I think, and we need to carry on the performance the level that we had tonight, and we need to try to keep improving. That's the job.
Well, yeah. I think it's 2 wins in 13 or 14, yeah. 1 win in 9. Up against it. They're not scoring any goals. They're still not scoring any goals.
Score in 10 out of 24 games he's been in charging, which is, I mean, there were these periods when he was right manager, and this is, it comes back to that,
the same,
you know, that they used to go through long stretches where his Brighton sides used to go through long stretches where they didn't score, and their XG was saying that they should be scoring, and there was the whole thing about how Brighton hate the underlying numbers. And I think this year it says that, you know, that they should have probably scored 11 times, and they've only scored 4 this calendar year. So what does that say about, I don't know what it, if it's something about the coach. I mean, it's certainly, they had loads of chances last night. Joao Felix hit the crossbar. He probably could have scored a couple of times. What can you do when your strikers don't finish? I mean, I suppose you could include Aubameyang in your Champions League squad, but, you know, that's just me.
What always concerns me when the coach comes out and says we've improved and we've actually just lost the game.
It's not great, but I think that's sometimes you're selling what's going on, not just to the media, but it's to your squad and sometimes to the boardroom. It's just gone 6:30. It's Thursday night. It's the Thursday night sports show. Let's get the latest news.
At 6:30 with the latest for London, I'm Will Schindler. A coalition of 5 councils has launched a judicial review to challenge both Transport for London and the Mayor's decision. London boroughs of Bexley, Bromley, Harrow and Hillingdon and Surrey County Council have brought legal action following TfL's announcement in November 2022 that it would push on with proposals to expand the scheme in August 2023. The